ऑर्थोपेडिक डिपार्टमेंट. स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे द टॉपिक इज द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द बोन्स एंड द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द जॉइंट्स. सो फर्स्ट वी स्टार्ट विद द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द बोन. द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द बोन इज कॉल्ड ऑस्टियोमेलाइटिस. वॉट इज ऑस्टियोमेलाइटिस? आई रिपीट अगेन, द ऑस्टियोमेलाइटिस इज द इन्फेक्शन इन द बोन. If it is the infection of the joint, it is called septic arthritis. It's not osteomyelitis of the joint. It is called septic arthritis if infection is in the joint. If there is an infection in the long bones or the other flat bones or the vertebra, it is called osteomyelitis. This infection or the osteomyelitis is more common in the long bones and the vertebras. Although it can affect any of the bone of the body as the hip bone or the scapula also. Which patients or who are the people who are more affected or who are more prone to osteomyelitis? Mostly these are premature infants, these are with children, or the elderly people, or the people who has immunocompromised states as in diabetes, hepatitis B, C, HIV, or the other immunocompromised states in which they are being given immunocompromised drugs. In adults, osteomyelitis is usually a subacute or chronic infection that would develop secondary to the open injury to the bone and the surrounding soft tissue. Although in the infants or in the children, it is a blood bone, the infection is somewhere else, like sore throat, like diarrhea, and it through the blood goes to the joints and to the bones. The vascular compromise can also cause osteomyelitis, such in the diabetic patients. What are the organisms which cause osteomyelitis? Many different type of bacteria and viruses can cause osteomyelitis. The most common of the bacteria which cause the osteomyelitis is Staph aureus. The bacteria can enter in the body through the different ways. For example, if there is an infection in the other part of the body, which I have already told you, a sore throat or an ear infection or any other part of the soft tissue area, it can go through the blood hematogenously to the affected bone. Number two, if there is any open fracture previously, it can become infect and will result in osteomyelitis of the underlying bone. Number third is a foreign object penetrating the skin. It can also result in osteomyelitis. Any previous operation on the limb, as if there is some orthopedic procedure, nailing or plating has been done in the past and now it has get infected, then the infected joints. Again, we discuss something about the various bacteria involved in osteomyelitis in the different age groups. Like in infants, Streptococcus B, Staphylococcus or Escherichia coli are the most common organisms seen in the osteomyelitis cultures. In the children, it is Staph aureus, Haemophilus influenza. In adults, it is Pseudomonas, Staph aureus, Staphylococcus epidermidis. Now, what are the symptoms when patient presents to you in the outpatient department or in the emergency, whatever the case would be? The symptoms would be that there is a swelling in the infected area, there is a swelling in the upper limb or lower limb, whatsoever is involved. There is a redness, there is a increased temperature or warmth locally in that area with the systemic features like fever. There is a tenderness, when you touch the area, and the patient is unable to use his infected extremity to extend or flex the extremity. The patient basically guards and protect the area from being touched or looked at. This is one of the classical pictures you have already read in your pathology books. This is the classical inflammatory signs, that is color, rubor, tumor, dolor, functio, lesi. In English, it's like warmth, redness, swelling, pain, and impaired function. Now, a few lines about the pathogenesis of the osteomyelitis. The normal bone is resistant to the infection. There is a very good blood supply, there is a covering layer periosteum, but once this is breached, as in the open fractures, the resistance is lost and there are more chances to get infected. Staph aureus has the receptors that increases the adhesion to the bone matrix or the foreign objects. Staph aureus can survive within the osteoclasts, which are one of the type of the bone cells you have already read in your histology books. These are the cells which eat up the bone. The microorganisms in the bone can develop resistance to the antibiotics. That is the reason why the acute osteomyelitis then goes into the chronic phase. And the chronic osteomyelitis is very, very resistant to the treatment. Pathophysiology, as in the acute phase, acute inflammation, there is increased blood supply or increased vascularization. There is edema and there is a cell infiltration. The inflammatory cells, you have already read about phagocytes. Phagocytes, macrophages, which eat up the debris and the infected area. This stimulates the breakdown of the bone. The increased tissue pressure then within the bone makes the necrosis of the bone of that part, which results in the dead bone, which we called sequestrum. So the sequestrum is the dead part of the bone, and the new bone formation is called involucrum. The abscesses and the sequestra, which is the dead bone, makes this infected part to very hard to treat by antibiotics. So whenever there is an abscess or there is a dead bone present in the infected area, the simple systemic oral intravenous antibiotics are very hard to treat the patient. So in those patients, we have to do some surgical debridements or have to do some surgical options. This is one of the pictures from your primary study ages. In the first year or maybe in second year, you have seen this picture in your histology books like Hussain Siddiqui. This is the metaphyseal and the epiphyseal blood supply of a newborn or a young child bone in which there are open physis. So if you see that there is a epiphyseal area, there is a metaphyseal area, and there is a diaphyseal area histologically, and this metaphyseal blood vessels cross the physis and then goes into the epiphyses. This is the major reason why whenever in the children there is an infection of the bone, it crosses the surrounding or corresponding joint very easily, because of this type of the blood pattern of the young skeleton. So in these patients, whenever there is an infection of the femur, they suddenly goes into the hip joint. In the children, the hip joint is commonly infected. The septic arthritis of hip joint is commonly seen in the children, while in adults, the knee joint is commonly affected. You mostly see the septic arthritis of the knee joint. Rarely the shoulder joint is involved. This is also one of the picture from your book showing the different organisms involved in the osteomyelitis. There are the gram positive that are staphylococci, streptococci, then the gram negative, enterobacterici, buclepsiella species, pseudomonas. Pseudomonas is commonly associated in diabetic foot infections. Haemophilus influenza, Neisseria, then some of the fungi in the immunocompromised patients, the fungal osteomyelitis is more common. Then is the mycobacterium, that is mycobacterium tuberculosis. In our part of the country, you will see the tuberculosis most commonly, especially the spinal tuberculosis. The vertebras or the spine is involved with this mycobacterium tuberculosis, that is called Pott's disease. You will see spinal tuberculosis. You will also see the tuberculous knee, or there may be some osteomyelitis because of the tuberculosis. In those cases, the ATT, that is the anti-tuberculosis drug, is given with some surgical debridement of the area too. So whenever you see any patient with the long-standing history, weight loss, anorexia, a chronic symptoms of the specific joint or the specific long bone, you will consider the mycobacterium tuberculosis in your minds and get ESR, which is very high in the tuberculosis cases, with other investigations were done to rule out the tuberculosis of the bone and joints. Now, a simple graphical representation how to diagnose a case of infection of the bone. First of all, you have a complete medical history. When you ask the patient, he will give you any history of any of the infection in other part of the body, or he will give you the history of any open fracture or previous instrumentation of any of the joint or any foreign body, or any history of the trauma in the past. After completing your medical history, you will go on to the physical examination. And on the local physical examination of the affected area, you will see that there will be decreased range of motion of that part of the lower limb or the upper limb, whichever is involved. When you touch the area, there is a local tenderness. Whenever there is a local tenderness, you must have something in your mind that there is something infective going on in this patient, especially when he has a history of fever also. So this gives you a doorbell sign that there is something infective process going on with the previous history which he has given you. When you get the labs of the patient were done, you will get the CRP positive. That is the C-reactive protein. The normal value is less than 6 nanograms per DL. But whenever there is an infection, the CRP rises for first 48 hours and then it goes down. You get the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, ESR, which is also increased. There will be leukocytosis. The TLC count, especially the neutrophils in case of the acute infection or the bacterial infection, is high. The other diagnostic tests which can be ordered are the radiographs, the ultrasound, the bone scan, MRI, biopsy, and the blood wound or the urine culture. Initially, in the first 2 or 3, 4 weeks, if you get the x-rays of a patient of acute osteomyelitis of a specific limb were done, you will seldom see any changes because it needs about 50% of the cortical bone destruction to for the features to appear on the radiographs. So you get the bone scan initially in initial weeks were done, which shows you the positive result. But this is non-specific. It does not give you about the disease, the name of the disease. It will only tell you about that there is some sort of infection going on it. Then if there are less facilities before the bone scan, you can get the ultrasound done, which will show you the abscess or the soft tissue collection in the surrounding bony area. MRI is also a very good investigation and it gives you the early diagnosis, especially in case of the vertebral infections, spondylitis or any abscess or tuberculous spine. You can also get the biopsy of that bone piece done, either by needle biopsy, either by open biopsy. A piece of the bone can be sent to the lab for culture and sensitivity and histopathology. The other cultures like blood culture, urine or wound culture can be done to see that if there is any systemic illness which has ended up in the hematogenous spread leading to the osteomyelitis of the area. Radiology, the pain the x-rays, I have already told you that they are not diagnostic in the acute osteomyelitis and it needs about 30-50% of loss of the bone mineral needed to show the signs. Although in the chronic osteomyelitis, it gives you the typical features or the typical signs that there is a periosteal thickening, there is a sclerosis, this white portion of the cortical bone that is called sclerosis is seen in the radiographs of the chronic osteomyelitis. Bone scan, it is positive within 2 to 3 days. The isotope used is technetium-99m. There are 3 phases of the bone scan. And in the 3 phases, there is an increased uptake because of the infective cells, which shows that there is some infective process going on. Although it is non-specific, the other diseases in which there is an increased bone metabolism, as in the Paget's disease or the other, the bone scan may be positive, or any of the bone forming tumors or the osteoblastic activity, the bone scan can be positive. MRI, I have previously told you that it is for the early diagnosis. It is better than the bone scan. It visualizes the soft tissues, the abscesses and the bone. In case of the osteomyelitis, especially in the vertebral osteomyelitis, spondylitis, any source abscess in case of tuberculous osteomyelitis of the vertebra, that is called Pott's disease. You can get the plain MRI or contrast can also be done. Then comes the open culture swab, bacteriological diagnosis. The blood culture can be done, the local culture can be done. As you see in the picture that there is some infected wound on the big toe, and this is a culture swab stick which picks up the culture and we send it to the laboratory, and then in 72 hours they grow the organism if there is any organism in the wound, and they will get the sensitivity of the antibiotic were done on that growth culture. The needle biopsy can be done, the CT or ultrasound guided biopsy, especially in cases of the vertebra, can also be done. Open biopsy can also be done, as I have told you earlier. at least you get 5 to 6 cultures to get the diagnosis of the organisms involved. And the deep culture is more important and is a better than the superficial cultures. Something about the classification of osteomyelitis on the basis of the way of spread. As earlier it has been told to you that in the children there is a hematogenous spread. The bacteria can also spread from the nearby tissue or the local area, as in the case of the open wound, any open fracture, any operation. The osteomyelitis can also be caused by the vascular insufficiency, as in the diabetic patients or any of the neuropathic with joints or any neuropathic diseases. This is one of the term which is called Brody's abscess. Brody's abscess is the subacute infection, or it is a subacute osteomyelitis. So you see an abscess and a sclerotic area around it. In the radiograph of the immature skeleton of lower tibia. Now we talk about one of a presentation, how this patient present, how the child present in the outpatient department. So you always suspect the arthritis or osteomyelitis if there is a limp in the child. If the patient comes, I repeat again, if the patient comes in the outpatient department with a limping gait, you have something in your mind that maybe he has got some septic arthritis or osteomyelitis if he do not have any history of trauma. Then on examination, there will be the local warmth in the extremity and patient will be unwilling to move his joint or his limb. So in this case, then you suspect that the child has some infection in the joint or the bone. You will get the investigations and the history from the patient, and the investigations which I have already told you, the hematological investigations, the x-rays, the other ones, to reach to the diagnosis before treating the patient. Now few things about the vertebral osteomyelitis. You will commonly seen in your outdoors that there is a back pain in the elderly patient. But if the patient presents to you with the back pain and associated history of weight loss, anorexia, evening pyrexia, low grade fever, any of the tuberculous contacts within his family, and chronic cough, sputum, hemoptysis, your mind should click that there may be some tuberculous event going in his vertebras. So when you get the x-rays were done, or more advanced investigation MRI were done, you will see that the vertebral collapse will be there. Although the disc in between the vertebra will also be involved. So if you see this picture in the slide below, this is a MRI of a vertebral column were done. This is thoracic 7 vertebra which has been collapsed. The lower end plates are collapsed. The underlying vertebra upper end plates are collapsed, and there is a jumble up of both the vertebras. You cannot judge the normal boundaries of these vertebras. As you see that there are the normal vertebras above it and below it, which have a specific boundaries. But in these two vertebras, the boundaries are jumbled up. So this is one of the classical presentations of tuberculous spots disease. Now we come with the chronic osteomyelitis. The chronic osteomyelitis have two phases. One is the active phase, the other is the latent or inactive phase. In active phase, you will see that patient has a pain, there is a fever, there is a sinuses, fistulas, discharging areas. And on the x-rays, you will see the sequestras, soft tissue swelling and osteolysis. Although some patients who present with dormant phase or inactive phase, they do not have the pain for long periods. And on the x-rays, you will only see the sclerosed bones or enlarged cortices, or I would say periosteal thickening. And you will not see the classical sequestra or osteolysis. This is one of the picture of the proximal part of the femur, which has a chronic osteomyelitis. Below the pictures are the clinical representation in the outpatient department. As I have told you earlier, which are the group of the people who are more prone to the osteomyelitis, the young people, the premature infants, the elderly people, the immunocompromised people, having HIV, having hepatitis B, hepatitis C, or immigrants from the third world countries. Now we come up with the treatment of the osteomyelitis. As we have previously discussed, that the antibiotics, the oral ones and the IV antibiotics, they are resistant to the osteomyelitis because of the abscesses, the sequestras were present in the infected bone areas. So there are some surgical principles and surgical options adjuvant with this antibiotic treatment. So first of all, primarily the non-operative treatment is to be done with the antibiotics. You get the cultures done, and this antibiotics which are sensitive to those cultures will be given for the 2 weeks intravenously, followed by 3 to 4 weeks orally. And meanwhile, you get the CRP, ESR, and clinically judge the patient whether the antibiotic is working or not. If it does not respond to this non-operative treatment, you have to go to the surgical option. Now, what are the principles of the surgery to treat the chronic osteomyelitis? The principle is to improve the local environment so the antibiotics can act more potently and effectively. So what are the principles? Number one, you remove all of the infected, devitalized, dead bone and soft tissue. If there is any abscess cavity present, you will evacuate it or decompress that abscess cavity. It will facilitate the antibiotic delivery to the area. When you remove that devitalized or the dead bone, the bone will become weak, the skeleton will become weak. It can break at any time if you do not stabilize it. So the fourth principle would be that you stabilize the instability which has been created after the removal of the infected part of the bone. Now, antibiotic therapy according to the bacteriological diagnosis, and before the bacteriological diagnosis, you can start up with the wide range antibiotics. You can also insert the local antibiotics. We will discuss in a few minutes what do you mean by the local antibiotics. Antibiotic therapy, as previously it has been discussed, that the intravenous broad spectrum antibiotics like cefuroxime, Zinacef for 1 to 2 weeks, followed by oral antibiotics. Antibiotics can then be changed after the cultures and the clinical courses. For example, if the Staph aureus is there, the cloxacillin or rifampicin. For the streptococcus, penicillin G or clindamycin is more affected. You follow the CRP, ESR, leukocyte and the clinical symptoms of the patient. The duration of the antibiotic treatment would be 4 to 6 weeks after the normalized CRP, that is C-reactive protein. This is how the surgical debridement of the devitalized bone tissue has to be done. You expose the part of the bone, you make a hole in the cortex, then you debride the bone. And after the adequate wide exteriorization, there will be the space created in the bone cavity, which increases it in stability. The bone can break at any time from there. So you put the bone graft in that area and stabilize it. And if you need more stability, you can apply the external fixator to stabilize the instability. So I repeat again that you expose the bone of the infected area, you make a window or a cortical hole, you debride the infected part of the bone, the dead bone, the sequestra, decompress any abscess, the soft tissue, then a space or the dead space, I would say that the dead space would be created and the bone will become more prone to the fracture or instability. Then you can fill that dead bone space by the bone graft. And if you think that the instability is still there, you can apply the external fixator to stabilize that bone. And with that all things, you will give the antibiotics for 4 to 6 weeks, initially for 1 to 2 weeks, intravenous antibiotics followed by the oral ones. And all things are to be monitored by the CRP, ESR and the clinical symptoms of the patient. Local antibiotics. So nowadays there are local antibiotics also available. We have a antibiotic cement, the bone cement, which is called PMMA, polymethyl methacrylate. We mix the gentamicin or the vancomycin in that bone cement. We make a small beads on the wires or on the non-absorbable threads, and after debriding all part of the devitalized dead bone, we put this local beads in that area, as you see in the picture also. For 4 to 6 weeks, these local antibiotic beads remain in that dead space. We close the wound over the suction drains. And then when the symptoms subside, the ESR, CRP becomes normalized. After 6 to 8 weeks, depending on the patient's condition, we remove these local antibiotic beads and fill the dead space either with the bone graft or either with the myosseous graft or muscle flaps. In the other part of the world, these sort of spongy foams mixed with the antibiotics are also available, which are called genta fleece or genta coil. What are the indications for the surgical operation in case of chronic osteomyelitis? whenever there is a active phase or there is a acute on chronic infection, patient has a high fever, he has a discharging sinuses, he has a osteolysis on the underlying inactive phase. So this ends up with the infection of the bones. Now the other part of the subject is the infection of the joints, which I have told you it is called septic arthritis. I repeat again, the infection of the bone is called osteomyelitis and the infection of the joint is called septic arthritis. What are the risk factors or who are the patients which are more prone to the septic arthritis? Are again a little bit of the repetition. Extreme of ages, young children, elderly people, underlying joint abnormalities like rheumatoid arthritis, immunocompromised patients as diabetes, HIV, hepatitis B or C, if there is any previous joint instrumentation, you have previously done some arthroscopy or you have injected the joint with a steroid a few weeks back and then the patient comes to you with a hot swollen red knee joint resulting in a septic arthritis. Intravenous drug abusers who are immunocompromised, bacteremia in any of the other part of the area. For example, if there is an immunocompromised patient, he has a diarrhea, he is on immunosuppressive drugs, and after 3-5 days of the diarrhea, he suddenly has a knee joint or the shoulder joint red, hot, swollen, painful, and there is a loss of active and passive motion of the joint. You can have that in one thing in the mind that he may have some infection of that joint, he may have some septic arthritis. You must be careful and you must be worrisome and you may get the investigations done for the patient. So the clinical features will be single, hot, swollen, painful joint, severe pain if any attempt is made to move the affected joint actively or passively. In children and in adults, the knee joint is the more commonly affected. In the neonates, it is the hip joint. Fever and other systemic signs can be present. So you make the diagnosis by the clinical findings, then you get the hematological investigations were done, the TLC count is raised, the ESR is raised, the CRP is raised, you aspirate the joint, you will get the infected fluid or pus coming out of it, which makes or confirms your diagnosis. And on that aspiration, you get the culture, gram positive, gram negative staining, ZN staining, AFB were done on it. The number of white cells seen is not diagnostic of sepsis, and the crystals may be seen in infected joint as well as gout or pseudo gout. So when you get the cell count on that infected fluid which has been aspirated from the specific joint, if that white cell count more than 25,000 or it is more than 25,000, 35,000 or say about 50,000, then you will see that the patient has septic arthritis. If the count is not of that number, you will not label it as bacteriological or bacterial septic arthritis. So in bacterial septic arthritis, the count of the white cell on aspiration of that fluid will be above 25-30,000 per ml. Now, how to manage this septic arthritis or the infected joint? First, the medical management, you start with the antibiotics as already been told, to you in osteomyelitis also. You give the antibiotics for 4 to 6 weeks, initially 2 weeks intravenously, followed by the oral antibiotics. Then comes the surgical management. The surgical management of the septic arthritis is the surgical drainage, which is called orthotomy. Orthotomy means opening up of the joint and washing it out with the normal saline. So, we're decreasing the infected load. The prompt surgical drainage is the priority in order to avoid the further cartilage damage of the joint. In general, open washout is preferred to the arthroscopic washout. I repeat again that you do the arthrotomy and do the open washout of the specific joint. So this is the radiograph of the septic arthritis of the hip. In figure A, you see that the septic these are the initial phases of the septic arthritis. You see that the head has started to collapse. There is more whitening of the head. It is becoming sclerosed. And then on the other side, if you see that the space between the acetabulum and the femoral head is been decreasing. And in the picture two, you see that the acetabulum has been destructed and the head has been eaten up and the proximal part of the femur has gone inwards towards the acetabulum, which is called protusio acetabuli, and the hip joint has been all gone. Something about the implant related septic arthritis. So this is the topic that is implant related septic arthritis, thereby meaning that some patient has some total hip or total knee replacement done, and after it he got that implant infected. So this defines the topic. The incidence in the good units after the joint replacement is now less than 1%. The late infection after the joint replacement can present with the grumbling type of startup pain. The patient, when wakes up in the morning and puts his first few feet on the ground, he started complaining of pain in his thigh or in his knee, whatever joint has been replaced. With some of the systemic symptoms like low grade fever, etc. And when you get the x-rays were done of the involved joint, you will see that there is a lucent areas. The lucent areas are the black areas around the joint which has been replaced. Next slides. So radiological finding is that you see the lucent areas around the implant. The multiple specimens need to be taken at the surgery for the reliable diagnosis. So when you do the surgery of that implant related septic arthritis, you remove that infected implant if the prosthesis is not stable, and you will get the multiple cultures obtained around the surrounding infected tissue. So when you see that there is a implant related infection, which is also called prosthetic joint infection, if the prosthesis or the implant is well fixed radiographically, you only debride the infected area and do not remove the implant, remain it there and give him antibiotics and the infection will settle down. But if you see that the prosthesis is also loosened and there is an infection, but then you have to remove the prosthesis also, remove the infected area, and if you feel like that the infection has settled down, you can revise it with the other implant, or you can close the area with the antibiotic cement. And in the second go or in the second stage, when the infection has subsided with normal CRP and ESR, you can revise the implant or the joint again. Multiple surgical samples are crucial for identifying a pathogen. Thorough, complete, fully excision of the infected tissue is a key determinant of the outcome. The long-term antibiotics may be used for the patients who are not suitable for major Avian surgery. And if you see that the patient is not a candidate for the surgery again because of his comorbid conditions, or he's a high risk for the anesthesia, or is not a suitable candidate for surgery, but then you can use the long-term antibiotics to treat the implant related infection or prosthetic joint infection. Now this is a radiograph. I will show you the infected total hip replacement. On the right hip, if you see, this is the cemented total hip were done. You see a femoral component, a head, and then you see a acetabulum component like an umbrella cap. And if you see the black arrow, you will see a blackish area underneath the greater trochanter and a very white prosthetic implant. That is called lucent area. The transluency has increased, which shows that implant is getting to loose, either of infection or either non-infective loosening. So if it is loosed, it can be removed and can be placed again when infection has subsided. But if it is not loosed, there are no loosening radiological signs, then you only debride the area and leave the implant retained in it. Now, few things about the diabetic foot infection. The global prevalence of the diabetes has increased in the recent years. Foot infections are a leading cause of a hospital admission in this group. The foot complications are more because of its combined influence of macro and microvascular insufficiency, mechanical disruption, and peripheral and autonomic neuropathy, immune defects, and impaired tissue healing. In the diabetic foot patients, you will see that commonly there is an ulceration of the heel area, calcaneum, or the bones of the forefoot, especially the metatarsal heads, then leading to the deep extension and resulting in the underlying osteomyelitis. Some patients may have fever and systemic symptoms in addition to the diabetic foot infection. If you get the plain radiographs of these patients, you can seldomly see the evidence of the osteomyelitis. In the earlier phases of the diabetic foot, you will not see the classical radiographic signs of osteomyelitis. But when it turns into the chronic osteomyelitis, secondary to the diabetic foot, you will see the chronic osteomyelitis radiological changes in those radiographs. MRI is the most sensitive imaging modality for the diagnosis of the bone involvement. It also tells you about the soft tissue involvement also. In extensive or complicated infections, antibiotic therapy should be guided by the results of the culture of deep bone or tissue samples obtained surgically. So I repeat again, if there is an early diabetic foot, you can treat it with some special footwears to decompress the pressure areas, give some antibiotics. But if there is an extensive infection and there is an underlying osteomyelitis and you want to give the antibiotics, you get the deep cultures of the soft tissues and the deep bone cultures surgically obtained to cure the disease. Meanwhile, you will also have to treat the diabetes. So when there is a good glycemic control of the patient, the healing will be better. The etiological agents of the diabetic foot infection are the same as that of the bone infection in the non-diabetic. More commonly, Staph aureus, beta hemolytic streptococci, Pseudomonas. Anaerobes may also be present in some of the cases. So if there is early initial stages of the diabetic foot, you will give the antibiotic therapy, optimizing the glycemic control, improving the vascular supply and relieving the pressure with appropriate footwear. You give them appropriate footwear, so it decreases their further damage. This approach may avoid more extensive tissue loss or later amputation. So you treat as earlier as possible the diabetic foot, the more better will be the prognosis of the patient, and he will not end up in amputation. Amputation is not an easy option in the diabetic foot, as wound healing is a problematic. The flaps which you have made after the amputation, many times because of the decreased blood supply to the flaps, get infected, and you have to revise your amputation many times. It goes high up, like below knee amputation, can end up in the above knee amputation if you do not treat the diabetes properly. In general, excision should be adequate to remove all the infected material, and excess bone may need to be resected to allow the tension-free skin closure. If you see that there is an extensive peripheral neuropathy along with the diabetic foot, it is better to do the below knee amputation in that area, because if you do the various foot amputation, because of the neuropathy, you will end up in high level of amputation and the patient will suffer more. So it's better to initially do the below knee amputation and give him prosthesis so he starts up his life easily. So this is one of the pictures of the diabetic foot. You see that there is a edema, there is a redness, there is erythema and slough, dead skin area, soft tissue area, a little bit of necrotic patch, and the metatarsal heads. And the metatarsal head, first metatarsal head, is also becoming exposed. So earlier, the lesson of the day is that the earlier you diagnose the diabetic foot, the earlier you treat it, the earlier you educate the patient for the better foot care, the better will be the chances for the survival of his normal foot, the better will be the prognosis of the disease. So, but this ends up with today's topic of infection of the bone and infection of the joint, and at the end, something about the diabetic foot. Any questions? पूछने के लिए हाँ भाई